Welcome to our second webinar. This part will cover deep neural networks and other new algorithms. This is part of a series of five that will be conducted by DGB Earth Sciences. My name is Paul de Groot, and the other webinars will be given by Hardeep Jaklan and Arno Huck. I will start by just refreshing our memory on the first webinar when I talked about shallow neural networks before I dive into deep networks. In the previous webinar last week, we talked about unsupervised vector quantizers and multi-layer perceptrons. Unsupervised vector quantizers were networks that were used for clustering, segmenting the data, and they are more or less similar to k-means type of clustering, and also because of the sorting that we do, akin to Kahuna networks. Then we talked about multi-layer perceptrons, and I just want to reiterate that these networks are fully connected networks, which means that every node in a layer is connected to all the nodes in the next layer. And that's important to remember, because in the next deep learning neural networks, we will not use a fully connected network, but the connections will only be partly, and that is the trick behind convolutional neural networks. Also, the organization of the networks in terms of layers, this is organized in vectors, one-dimensional layers, is different in a convolutional neural networks. Today we will be talking about convolutional neural networks, recurrent neural networks, generative adversarial neural networks, and autoencoders as part of the deep learning neural networks. And then we will talk about other algorithms, starting off with decision trees, and then we move into random forests and boosting algorithms. So let's start with convolutional neural networks. So convolutional neural networks are networks that are used for analyzing images, or actually anything that can be represented in the form of 1D, 2D or 3D, in which you cannot change the order of the input without changing the results. For instance, in an image you cannot just take out a column of the data and move it somewhere else, because then you get a completely different image. They're very powerful and used also in seismic imaging, very successful to predict, among others, faults and seismic facies, etc. The trick in a convolutional neural network is that in the convolutional layer, you're not connecting all the nodes to all the nodes in the next layer, but you're only connecting it to a subset. And by doing that, the connections start to act as a kind of convolutional filter. So basically you're decomposing the image into a set of filtered image, and that is passed on to the next layer. So the convolutional layer also takes over the function of extracting attributes from the data. Instead, in our seismic analysis, we give the full seismic volume, a cubelet around the analysis point, to the CNN, and then it's up to the CNN to extract the relevant features in the convolutional neural layer. So the convolutions can be 1D, 2D, and 3D, and that is applied to either vectors, 2D images, or 3D volumes. And optionally, you can also give your input as red, green, and blue channels. Now let's see how it works for a 2D convolutional type of network, so for images. And I picked this up from the internet. And what we're going to do is we're just talking our way through these images to see what the network actually is computing. So the image is on the left, 6x6 image. The values are the pixel values, or the amplitude values in the case of seismic. And we're going to map this input by passing it through a filter, and the filter coefficients are basically the weights that we will find in the learning phase of our training phase or the training process. So the input is convolved by this filter. So we take the value here in the left upper corner, 4, multiply it by 1. We add the next value, multiply it by 0, plus 2 times minus 1, and so on. So this is a convolutional operation, and the output is mapped in this cell on the right. Now then we move the whole filter one position to the right, and we compute the next value. So if we do this, we are basically remapping the 6x6 input into an output that is 4x4. Now instead of taking one step at a time, this is called the stride, we can also take a step of 2, a stride of 2. And if we do that, we are mapping the 6x6 image to an even smaller output, 4x4. Sorry, 2x2. Only 4 elements. Now, often we then run into some kind of edge effect. So to avoid that, we can pad some zeros, and that will change the results a little bit on the edges. If we work with RGB input, then each of these channels is convolved with its own filter, and then the filters are stacked up to produce the end result. So in this case, the RGB input is having dimensions 6x6x3, and the end result of the three convolutional filters is an output of 4x4. Now we do that not just for one filter, but we create a whole stack of filters, and each filter produces its output. So the output of 6x6x3 with two filters is ending up in images of 4x4x2. An entire convolutional layer therefore consists of the filters, which map the input to a new dimensional space. And for each filter we have this output. We then pass this through some kind of activation function. And then after the activation function is applied, we can also add a bias, and that would be the final output of one convolutional layer. Now apart from the convolutional layer, which maps one image into a stack of filtered images, we also have a few other tricks in the back. We can introduce pooling layers, and these are used to shrink the image, basically to blur the image a little bit, like we did with the stride of 2. We're just making it a bit smaller, and that is similar to what you're doing when you look at a lower resolution image. You get an output in which small variations of the input are less important. So you can correct for that by introducing pooling layers. The normalization layer, we need to apply that to keep the math from exploding. And basically this ReLU normalization, which is very often used, is just changing the negative values to zeros. And then we can also add a fully connected layer, like we did in the multilayer perceptron, and that is often used in the end as a nonlinear transformation to compute the vote for the winners. Now here we see an adaptation of the famous LeNet network, which was the first convolutional neural network introduced by LeCun in 1998. We start with an image, we go to a convolutional layer. We may do some subsampling, which is similar to pooling. More subsampling, maybe another convolutional layer. And finally, we do some fully connected layers to create the output. And each of these layers you can analyze, and you can see that in the first convolutional layer, the image is really broken up in all kind of smaller images, which are really detecting the edges and the smaller bits and pieces of the image. And thereafter we are combining these small images back into an image that we can then either classify or recognize. Now, if you are working with convolutional neural networks, then you can play with many different parameters. So the architecture of the network is becoming important, and you play with the convolutional layer itself. You can change the input parameters, the number of features, the size of the features. You can add pooling layers to change the size of the window. You can play with the stride of the windows. You can add fully connected layers, and you can apply all these different layers in multiple times to build ever more complex neural networks. In our seismic world, we have applied this successfully to create seismic phases cubes. We have also run it on the chimney cube, and on the right you see a comparison between a conventional chimney cube created with attributes and a shallow multilayer perceptron type of neural network, and we compare it with a convolutional neural network, which makes the response quite different, much more a binary response. It's really chimney or non-chimney and not as gradual as the multilayer perceptron. And it also gives then rise to different types of interpretation. So it's for the chimneys, the verdict is not out yet whether this is helping us or not. The next networks we are talking about will be recurrent networks, the GANs and the autoencoders. Recurrent neural networks, they have a built-in memory, and that's done by feeding back the predictions, the outputs, back into the network as input. And by doing this, we can remember what the previous example was, and this is having like a memory function built in. It's not so used, not used very much in our line of business, but there is definitely possibilities to use this, especially in log-log prediction or anything that has some kind of cyclic development. And we think we should be trying this out in the near future, if these recurrent networks can do something for us in especially in log-log predictions. They can be trained with supervised learning algorithms and also with reinforcement learning algorithms, and they're especially famous in speech recognition. Long-short-term memory networks is a special form of a recurrent neural network with a built-in memory unit in which the outputs can also be used either to forget if they're not good, or they can be ignored and they can be selected as input again. These networks prevent the backpropagation errors from vanishing or exploding. And it can learn tasks that require memories of events that happened thousands or even millions of discrete steps earlier. Now, GANs have been reported in the literature quite a few times in the recent years. And these networks actually consist of two networks that are competing with each other. One network is trying to fool the other network by creating fake examples, and the other network has to discriminate between real data offered to the network and fake examples offered by the generator. And this also is a network that has a lot of potential in seismic applications. Here's an example I picked up from the Leading Edge. On the left we see a seismic input, and this input has been supersampled by a GAN. So the GAN network learned to to interpolate data both in X and in the time axis. And if we then did a fault prediction on both data sets, also with a convolutional neural network, then the super sampled data gave a better result, as we can see here on the right, where the faults are imaged even sharper than the faults on the left, which are directly applied to the conventional native seismic, so without the interpolation applied. The UNET is an autoencoder. It consists of a part in which we try to decompose the image or the input into ever smaller units. That's the encoding part. And then we try to rebuild another image from the smaller parts into an image or an output which has exactly the same size as the input. So this is typically used for image-to-image type of predictions. In addition to the encoding-decoding part, we also have some additional connections built in this network, which directly go from one layer, input layer, to the output layer, and from one intermediate step to the corresponding intermediate step on the output layer. These connections are called skip links, and these are given to make to give the network a better chance of actually finding the solution back. In OpenDetect, the machine learning plugin, we have used this UNET to predict faults, and this fault predictor network will be shipped with the machine learning application. It's a super fast application. You can really, within minutes, produce a fault cube of many gigabytes. And the results are really stunningly good. Now let's talk about some other algorithms: decision trees, ensemble learning, random forests, and boosting. And I will start with decision trees. A decision tree is a very popular predictor because it's very easy to understand what's going on. The prediction is made on the basis of a number of questions, and it can be used for both regression type of problems as well as for classification type of problems. In the example here, the question is, do we want to play golf or do we want to stay home? And we have a number of predictors like the weather outlook, temperature, humidity, whether it's windy or not, and based on that we can make a decision to play golf or not. And we can easily follow what's going on. We just have built the tree such that we first look at the outlook. Is it sunny or overcast or rainy? If it's overcast, then we will always play golf, but if it's sunny, we also want to look at whether it's windy or not, and based on that we will either go and play golf or not. Now, this is it's what is called a weak predictor. It gives you one possible outcome, and it's these weaker combinations or these weaker predictors can be combined into a more accurate predictor using ensemble techniques. And in ensemble methods, we have a few keywords that we must know. We talk about bootstrapping. That is a random selection with replacement. And that means that if I, for instance, have 100 features that I can choose from and I want to select 50 of them, then I select one of these features at random. And for the next selection, I will also have 100 features to choose from. So I'm not removing the one that I've chosen from the set. It stays there so that I can also select it again. So out of the 50 that I will select, I will most likely have multiple selections of certain features. That is called random selection with replacement or bootstrapping. Another important concept is aggregation, which is generating the optimal output from all individual models. So how do we create the final result from the individual decision trees or the individual weaker predictors. And bagging is the combination of bootstrapping and aggregation. Now, random forests is one of the more popular prediction models at the moment. Again, they can be used for regression as well as classification problems. And random forests are ensemble methods based on decision trees, whereby each tree in the random forest is created by bootstrapping, so random selection with replacement, and also when we split the tree further on in the tree, these splits are based on random selection of the features. The two important parameters to play with in random forests are the number of estimators, so how many trees do I have in the forest, how many decision trees, and the maximum depth of the forest, so how many splits will I make to do my prediction. Now, if I take too many splits, so the depth, then I can run the risk of overfitting my data. But the number of estimators is a parameter that just takes up computer time. It will not change the result as such, except that more estimators will be better. But at some point, of course, you have saturated the results, and then there's no need for adding more estimators. In regression problems, so how do we aggregate? In regression problems, the results are averaged over the endnodes. And in classification problems, we output the most frequent occurrence of all endnodes. We have used random forests in predicting acoustic impedance and VP-VS ratio from pre-stack simulated data. And in this particular example, we had 20,000 pseudo-wells, 20,000 pre-stack gathers. We had 13 angle stacks created from each of these stacks, and we extracted the amplitudes just above the point of evaluation at the evaluation point and the point below. So we had three attributes for every sample position, and then we slided this window along the pre-stack gather to convert the pre-stack data into acoustic impedance or VP over 3S ratio. We did that with a random forest prediction that had 200 number of estimators, so 200 trees in the forest and a depth of 50. Then another ensemble method, boosting. This is a method in which models are trained sequentially as opposed to separately, and that means that each model is trained to correct for errors made in the previous models. And XGBoost is at the moment the most popular boosting algorithm because it's an extremely fast gradient descent boosting algorithm, and it operates on decision trees and random forests. And we have used that and implemented this in the machine learning plugin to predict logs from other logs. So here's an example where the input consists of RoB, DT, RD, and gamma ray logs, and the output is pore volume or porosity. And the predictor is the XGBoost algorithm. Now this is my last slide, so I'm open for questions. Thank you very much for your attention.